it's a sin. I wanna know about being born again. I need you. Oh Lord, I need you. So take me to the riverside. Take me under bad times. I need you. Oh God, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet.
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change.
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. Yeah.
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing.
worship. So my wife is sitting right there, is on the arts team, and she's been, well, she's an arts team, so she knows that the sermon is about hurry and about rushing. And she reminded me that I wrote a song 20 years ago about rushing and about hurry. And it was at a time, 20 years ago, we had a child in 93, 96, 98, 99, and 2000. So there was a lot of rushing and there was a lot of hurry. So this song is called Spoken For. And by the way, there's CDs out there. Take as many as you need. The song is on there, plus 11 other songs. So anyways, this song is called Spoken For. It's about rushing, and it's about, sometimes we compartmentalize God. We like, you know, we make time for him in our life, but we don't give him our entire life. This song is about, the first part is about kind of departmentalizing and then realizing that we need to give God everything. We need to turn everything over to God. So this is called Spoken For. Here we go.
This to-do list, it's 100 miles long. The phone keeps ringing as it plays that silly song. I've got 100 emails that all need a reply. The papers on the desk piled way up to the sky. I push away the coffee as my hands begin to shake. I shut the door and dim the lights and close my eyes to pray. And now I'm spoken for, and all my time is yours. There's not a call ahead of you, cause you're the one I'm talking to. Now I'm spoken for, you won't be ignored. I let go of this weight, and the worry falls away. Now my heart is restored. You, I'm spoken for. It's 5 and I'm headed home like 1,000 times before. But I can't remember driving as I arrive at the door. So I stand for a moment to gain some energy. Kids who've come running when they hear daddy's keys. Lying in bed exhausted, another hard day. Can't feel your presence, so I close my eyes and pray. Now I'm spoken for, all my time is yours. There's not a call ahead of you, cause you're the one I'm talking to. Now I'm spoken for, let go of this weight, and the worry falls away. Now my heart is restored. With you I'm spoken for. This morning, work plans filled my head. My Bible hit the floor as I bumped out of bed. Seek first the kingdom, you know it stared up at me. And this part-time Christian began to read. And it was that moment my life turned around. You took my to-do list and you turn it upside down. And now I'm spoken for. All my time is yours. There's not a call ahead of you, cause you're the one I'm talking to. Now I'm spoken for. You won't be ignored. I let go of this weight, and the worry falls away. Now I'm spoken for. All my time is I invited you inside, no more pushing you aside. Now I'm spoken for, my life is with you, Lord. My priorities have changed, you know my life's been rearranged. Things are different than before, with what the future has in store. Your love has opened up the door. With you I'm spoken for.
Right. That is an original by Jason Crane, and he's got a whole box of CDs at the front door or on the way out, and has invited you, whole box, all right, and has invited you to take some of those CDs with you on your way out this morning. Well, hey, my name's Adam Rosanis. It is good to see you. I'm glad you're here. For those of you joining us online, thanks for joining us as well. Before I jump into announcements, we're going to play a little game called Lake or Fake. This is a radio game I play with my listeners. I've got a list of 5 Minnesota lake names. You have to tell me if they're real lakes in Minnesota or a fake lake that I made up. So I'm gonna give you the name of a lake, and if you think it's a real lake, raise your hand. If you think it's a fake lake, leave your hand down. All right, here we go. Adelman's Pond. Do you think there's an Adelman's Pond in Minnesota? Raise your hand. Just a few of you. All right, maybe about half. There is. That's a real lake in Minnesota. It's in Bloomington. That's where you can find that one. All right, do you think there's a buffalo chip bog? Is there a buffalo chip bog in Minnesota? Someone in the back is laughing. Raise your hand if you think that's real. One. All right, a brave one. No. Sorry, bud. There's no buffalo chip bog. I made that one up. Is there a northern light lake in Minnesota? Raise your hand if you think northern light lake is a real lake. Most. Yeah, that's a good guess. That is a real lake. That one is near Grand Marais, naturally. Is there a Lake 928? Lake 928. Raise your hand if you think that's a real lake in Minnesota. Again, about half. That is a real one. It's near Zempel, Minnesota. I don't know where Zempel is. If anyone knows, you can tell me. All right, one more. Is there an albino moose lake in Minnesota? Is that a real lake or a fake lake? Raise your hand if you think albino moose lake is real. Just a few of you guys. No, I made that one up. There's no albino moose lake. All right, that is lake or fake. Did anyone get all 5 right? Really? Honestly? Because you were here first service? Yeah. All right. We got a winner this morning. All right, here's what's going on at the quarry. You may notice in the days ahead that we've got a simpler version of the quarry building. We're getting ready for our big move. We've been moving stuff out. You may notice some furniture missing, some random boxes placed here or there, some cleaned out closets. God has not given us a definitive location yet as far as where we're going next, but we're trusting him to make that clear. In the meantime, we got to get out of this space. There is a buyer, and so we are moving things. We've made a keep pile, a giveaway pile, and a throwaway pile. And next Sunday, we're going to give you an opportunity to go through the keep pile, or actually, I'm sorry, the giveaway pile. We have moved all of that stuff to the southeast corner of the building, the old SWAT baseball location, and we're going to give you an opportunity to go through and buy whatever is there that you might want. So please join us for that after the second service next weekend. We do need help as we make this transition, and so if you've got some time available or just interest in helping, please get in contact with our office manager, David Northenskold. We'd be happy to put you to work. This last Tuesday night, we held our first grief share meeting. We had a great turnout, and we are grateful to be offering this support to those going through grief. It is hard to lose someone, and we don't want anyone going through that journey, the processing of that alone. Grief share is just a group of friendly, caring people who want to walk through grief with you. And so if you have experienced a loss or know someone who has recently, or maybe not even recently, it could have been years ago, but just still processing and going through that, we invite you to join us every Tuesday night here at the Quarry Building, 6:30 to 8:30. This is going on all the way through the beginning of April, so feel free to join us when you can. You can find more details at our website, quarrychurch.com. And then finally, here in a couple weeks, January 28th, we're looking forward to kicking off a new kind of course or just discussion time called Alpha. Alpha is a low-pressure environment just to work through life's big questions, kind of talk about the Christian faith together. We've actually got a short video that I think will do a really good job of explaining that further. Let's give that a watch.
This old friend of mine, Helen.
My best friend.
My friend Colin invited me to try Alpha.
Y recuerdo que mi papá me dijo, mira, hay comida gratis, ve.
They handed me a invitation.
It was just a random invitation.
And I said, like, why not? Let's try it.
Why not? Let's go.
And I found like a really awesome community of people.
They helped me find who I was just by listening.
Alpha helped me in the knowing of God.
Empecé a entender que el amor es de muchas maneras.
I just knew.
I was a different person from that moment on. I knew I had purpose.
I felt really comfortable and like starting to invite my friends.
I've seen Alpha really impact people that I work with.
I would definitely encourage people to get involved. It's one of the coolest things I've ever experienced.
It all turned out to be life-changing.
So we'll kick that off on January 28th. We're looking forward to that and invite you to join us and maybe someone you know who's just kind of got questions and invite them to join as well. You can find more details and register online again at our website, corychurch.com. All right, that's what's going on. Again, I'm glad you're here this morning. I'm going to invite you to stand and just give a warm welcome to the people around you this morning.
Good. Hey, if you're with us here in person, really glad. Glad that you're here. Glad to see your faces. If you're joining us online, equally glad that you're here. I understand why you're not. Man, I just want you to know that we miss you, and I know that you miss coming together. I just don't want to stop saying that because I don't want you to forget. It's a big deal. We are we're in this series that we're calling The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry, and it's after a book by the same title by Mark Comer. And if you haven't picked up that book yet, I encourage you to do what you need to do, Amazon or Christian Book Distributor, whatever that is, and pick up the book. It's an easy read, but it will shake you, and it will form you. And that's really what we're here to do, is to grow in a relationship with Jesus. So before I jump into week two here, let me pray, invite God in this time. And then we'll see what God has for us, all right? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, God, thank you for this day. Thank you that we can come together, Lord, and the promise is that you're here with us. Father, we ask that you would give us ears to hear. We know that you're speaking. Sometimes we can't hear, God, for whatever reason, but I ask that you would clear that up today. And we would hear your voice, that we would be encouraged, that we'd experience your peace and your joy, God, and that we would take a step further towards you in our relationship with you, God. We love you, and we're so grateful that you're here with us. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, so another author that I encourage you to read, especially if you need to smile, is a guy by the name of Bob Goff. Bob Goff. I've got a picture of him here. Bob's kind of crazy. He's a wonderful man who is making a difference, spending his life on all different kinds of things. But one area where he's kind of drilling down is in the country of Uganda. So Uganda is a war-torn country, and one of the casualties of war is the next generation. It's the children. And so he is working to affect the children in Uganda. Actually, there's an African saying that wherever two elephants fight, the grass pays the price. And when these two people groups came together and they warred, the one who paid the price was the children. And so he's there to make a difference. And so he goes there regularly. He's engaged with indigenous people who are on the ground doing things. But he writes this about one of his visits. He said, after an afternoon playing with the kids, we got back in the Jeep. He said, I was waving goodbye, and about 10 kids starting running behind the Jeep as we pulled away. I kept waving, all of us smiling and laughing, and the pack of kids started to grow. Now there were 20 of them running after us, and I figured one hand waving wasn't enough. So I got both hands waving, waving as fast as I could. Now there were 30 kids. And I'm a big fan of waving, and I hate goodbyes. But after several minutes of this, my arms started to get tired. So I asked the driver what the deal was, as the crowd of kids now running after the car had grown to 40. And he told me with a grin that the gesture of waving your hand in North America is used to say hi or goodbye. In Ugandan, it means follow me. He writes, what I realized in that moment is this is exactly what I've been doing to Jesus for most of my life. I've been merely waving at the person who's been inviting me to follow. Friends, I want to set the tone for today and just be really clear. Jesus has invited you on this adventure called your life. This is your life. And he did it so you could fulfill the promises that he has for you, to be fully alive and to be fully his. If you want to experience the full life that God has for you, then you're going to have to engage this. You're going to have to give yourself over to him. You're going to have to step into his way, into his lifestyle. Jesus is knocking at the door of your life because he wants the whole room, not just to have you kind of take a safe look back at through a little peephole or through the crack in the door and the crack that you're in. Listen to his words for you. These are words for you. This is John 15. He says, I am the vine. Jesus is talking about himself. He says, I am the vine, and you are the branches. The one who remains in me and I in him bears much fruit. But apart from me, you can accomplish nothing. It says, if anyone does not remain in me, he is thrown out like a branch and dries up. And such branches are gathered up and thrown into the fire and burned up. And this isn't punitive. It's just the way it is. If we don't stay connected to the vine, the branches connected to the vine, we dry up. But if we stay connected, here's the promise. There's fruit. We bear much fruit. And who doesn't want to bear fruit? Who doesn't want life that's truly life? I believe this about you, that you want life. Real life, you crave it. That like me, you're tired of a purposeless grind day after day, filling your life to overflowing with stuff. Some of it really good stuff, but just too much stuff, not leaving room for that which is most important. And so we just kind of wave at Jesus. We acknowledge, hey, Jesus, I see you, but hey, I'm not making room. Our lives already too busy, filled with lesser things. So it's like life for you is an overstuffed suitcase. Full of all kinds of things. Hobbies, work, kids, our houses, leisure, worry. We stick a little worry in there too, right? Suitcases that are full to overflowing. And then we learn about this Jesus. And we say, well, you know, I want a little of that too. So I'm gonna open this thing up. I'm gonna find a way to fit a little Jesus in here. Let's see if we can do this. And so we open up the suitcase, and of course it's full to overflowing. Think, man, how am I going to, I wish I had a smaller Jesus. Anybody got just like the New Testament I could put in there? You know, but we do. We pack it all down, and we make room amidst everything else. Of course, we don't take anything else out. We just kind of shove it in there with a little bit of Jesus, and then we, you know, we'll make it fit because we can. It's what we do. We just make it all fit in there for the glory of God. Little Jesus, and then we take the case down, and we're ready to go. Wherever we want to go, we kind of take a little Jesus with us. But here's the thing about Jesus. See, Jesus, he's the king. He's like nothing else, right? And he's not asking to abide in you. He's asking that you abide in him. That you abide in him, that you come to him, that you go away with him. And that we leave the suitcase. We leave all the other stuff. And we follow him so that we might stay connected to Christ, so we might be able to focus on him, so we might be able to go where Jesus goes, walk, live the way of Jesus. Because with Jesus, there's life. He's the vine. That's where we find life. He's the goal. He's the prize. Not the stuff. We said this last week, quoting John Ortberg, we said that hurry is the great enemy of spiritual life in our day. It's hurry, right? Hurry destroys the soul. Now, I want to dig down in this just for a minute because I think there's some confusion about hurry, right? Like if you follow Jesus, you can't move with speed and intentionality or work diligently at something. That's not it. That's not it. See, as a people of God, we actually view work as worship. If you go all the way back to the beginning, I mean like the very beginning, when God created, that beginning, when he spoke and there was nothing and all of a sudden there's something, God gave us, his creatures, God gave us the job of caring for the garden. We find this in Genesis 2. Work wasn't punishment. Work wasn't a curse. It was a privilege to join God in caring for what he created. It's our privilege. Now, that all changed with the fall when sin corrupted God's good creation. But the purpose behind work, it remains the same. In fact, the Apostle Paul, he wrote this to the church of Colossae. He said, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. We talked about inheritance a couple weeks back. It's secure in Jesus. And he finishes with this. He says, it is Christ, it is the Lord Christ you are serving. So whatever you do, work at it with all that you are. Work is a good thing. Working hard is a good thing. But hurry is a distorted view of work. Hurry happens when we wrap our identity, who we are, who we believe we are, around what we do rather than whose we are. When our identity becomes what we do, then work becomes our God. We believe that that the more we do, the better we do, we're more valuable to people around us. We're more valuable to our God. But that's not the heart of our God. That's not the message of the gospel. See, what he wants from us is not your work. He wants us to abide in him, to be connected to him, to be close to him, in relationship to him, to know him, to follow him, to work when it's time to work, and understand that whatever it is that we're doing, that we work for his glory, to bring him honor. Now, for some of you, work really isn't the issue. It's not that you hurry equals like too much work or speed of work. I was talking with my wife about this last week, and she said, you know, after last week's message, she said, you know, this whole hurry thing, I'm not sure I've got a problem with hurry. I think actually you have to move a little faster. And I'm thinking, well, that's not true with my wife. She's got plenty This is all about people. But see, for some of you, you have filled your life not with work, but with just stuff. It's like we can't help ourselves. There's this void, there's this empty space. It's like that counter at your house that was empty and clean, but all of a sudden it just fills up with stuff. Magically, things appear and the clutter appears. This is our lives. More and more things. Your life is kind of like this overstuffed suitcase. It's full to overflowing with a little too much of this, a little too much of that, and no room, no place for Jesus. So hurry. Hurry is when we don't have time for the one who gives us time. Hurry is when we don't have time for the one who feeds our souls. See, hurry keeps us clinging to a rhythm of life that is unsustainable. Hurry distracts us from Jesus. Hurry destroys the soul. And so somehow we have to ruthlessly eliminate hurry from our lives and cling to a pace, to a rhythm that instead of destroying our souls, feeds our souls. And so over the next few weeks, I want to give you some basic ideas, some thoughts of what it might look like in your life to eliminate hurry. So some tools, some practices or disciplines that will help you eliminate hurry. Now, before the more spontaneous in our group shut down, before those people who like the wide curves in life, you know, right now all you're thinking is, oh, he's talking about systems, he's talking about lists, and I don't want to even, you're just checking out right now. Well, stay with me, because I might be in that group. We're not creating structure for the sake of creating structure. Structure's not the goal. Structure is a tool for us because during these early stages of kind of pushing back hurry in our lives, most of us need additional support. We need structure to cement the necessary changes that we desire. And so a spiritual discipline or spiritual practice is that kind of support. It's a means for us to achieve spiritual health, soul health, life that's truly life. A few years ago, I was experiencing chronic heel pain. And I dreaded waking up in the morning because I knew I had to take those initial steps. And I could barely take them. I mean, it was excruciatingly painful. And so I'd sit there and I would stretch for the first 5 minutes in my bed and then painfully take those steps. Well, finally I got to the point because I couldn't exercise anymore. I couldn't run. I felt physically stuck. And so I bit the bullet and I talked to a doctor. I'm like, dude, can you help a guy out? Is there something I can do? And he said, well, I've got two options for you. The first option is we can do surgery. And we can cut your Achilles off your heel, and we could take away any kind of scar tissue there is there and reattach, and you would be absolutely immobilized for about 6 weeks. And then between 6 and 12 months of rehab, you might be able to walk without any pain. Like, no guarantees. Okay, great. What's option B? He says, well, I have this boot, this rigid boot, and you could wear this thing around for 3 months. I don't know if it's going to help, but it's worth a try. And with that kind of certainty, I took option B. Now, that boot became my friend for the next 3 months. I wore it everywhere. I mean, literally everywhere I went. I went hiking in the North Woods with my boot on and my kids with me. We did Halloween with the boot. You know, a couple of hours on a knee scooter roaming the streets of Monticello. It was awesome. Right, I slept with the boot. It became my friend. And you know what? 3 months into this process, I didn't have any heel pain. You see, that boot provided the structure I needed, the support I needed so my body could heal. It was kind of a discipline of sorts. And I needed that discipline to make me strong enough to do that which I currently could not do on my own. Discipline, better yet, spiritual disciplines, they really can be our friend. Even if you're not a structure person, we need this because they give us access to power that we don't have. They help us to exercise our capacity to do the right thing, kind of buffer our willpower. But here's the real power of a spiritual discipline. When we engage these practices, we open ourselves up to a power far beyond our own. We engage the power of the Holy Spirit. See, spiritual disciplines create time and space to access God Himself at the deepest level of our being. And God is the prize. It's not about the practice. It's going after the prize. The practice only helps us get to the prize. And God is the prize. Dallas Willard, he says this about spiritual disciplines. The disciplines are activities of mind and body purposefully undertaken to bring our personality and our total being into effective cooperation with the divine order. It's about aligning us with God, supporting us in that relationship. They enable us more and more to live in a power that is, strictly speaking, beyond us, deriving from the spiritual realm itself. It's how we get in touch with our King. Now listen, let me be clear. This isn't some legalistic guilt trip where we all get sheets of paper with little check boxes and we can check them off and we can compare them with one another and we can say, oh, look how I'm doing. I'm doing better than you. That's not what this is. This is an invitation to the life that you are aching for. A life that can be found only by moving through this world shoulder to shoulder with Jesus. Where are we going, Jesus? Where are we going? Where you go, I go. You step, I step. This is an invitation into the way of Jesus, the lifestyle of Jesus. And so, the question is, are there practices? Are there spiritual disciplines that will help us develop our relationship with God, to go further in our relationship with God? Maybe even disciplines that Jesus used, His way. And it just so happens there are. So if you have your Bibles, I want you to open up with me to Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4. This is a story that's found in 3 out of the 4 Gospels. You'll find it in Luke, a very, very similar telling of the story. And then you'll find it again in Mark. And Mark is well known for kind of summarizing well. His story is much shorter. Jesus is about to go into His public ministry. And before this, nobody really knew who Jesus was or what He was going to do, what God had called Him to do. But in the Father's time, and it was the Father's time, Jesus went out to John the Baptist. Remember, John the Baptist is actually Jesus' cousin. He goes out to John the Baptist, who's out in the wilderness. He's preaching, He's calling people to repentance, and He's baptizing people. He finds John the Baptist, and He asks John to baptize Him in the Jordan River. And Scripture says that in that moment, the heavens opened up and the Spirit of God came down like a dove. And the voice of God could be heard. This is My Son, whom I love. With Him I am well pleased. And what a great way, right, to start this new initiative. But what's interesting to me is what happens right after that. We read this, that then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, He was famished. The tempter came and said to Him, if You are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread. What we read about here is if you read the rest of the story, the devil tempts Jesus 3 different times, kind of goes after Jesus. And we kind of expect this to happen, right? Good and evil combating. We knew it had to happen, but this is a heavyweight spiritual battle. And the way that I have read this for years is that the devil waited until Jesus was weak, until He was exhausted, and then he attacked, right? I mean, because we read that Jesus literally hadn't eaten for 40 days and 40 nights. He was out in the wilderness in the Eremos. The Greek is the Eremos. For almost a month and a half, fasting, going without food. And in my mind, Jesus is weak. He's wasted. He's exhausted. An easy target. And isn't that just the way that Satan works? right? After a long work week, after a long day in the middle of a crisis in our own personal wilderness, he shows up. And that's when he attempts us. That's when he attacks us. Because that's when we're easy prey, right? We lose our cool, we take the bait, we take the drink, we turn on the internet. But that's not what happened with Jesus. You see, what I thought was a liability, I mean, spending time in the wilderness was actually a powerhouse. It was his power source. In my limiting thinking, I envisioned Jesus out in the middle of the desert, right? Sun beating down on him, no water, no food. He's done. He's near the edge of life. I had it all wrong. All wrong. See, the wilderness, the eremos, it's not a place of weakness. It's a place of strength. We read that Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness because it's there and only there that Jesus was at the height of his spiritual powers. We read later that Jesus says that there's a food that you don't know anything about, and that food is being in the presence of God. That's where his strength comes from. So it was after a month and a half of prayer and fasting in that quiet place that he then had the capacity to take on and take out the devil, coming out unscathed. And that's why we read over and over again, Jesus coming back to the wilderness, coming back to the eremos. Now that word, the Greek eremos, which in Matthew 4 is translated as wilderness, the range of meaning there, it can also mean desert or desolate place or solitary place, lonely place, quiet place. As you read the biography of Jesus, you'll notice that the eremos is a regular part of his way, of his life. This lifestyle of getting away to the eremos. In Mark chapter 1, after a marathon first day of ministry as the Messiah, we read that then Jesus got up early in the morning. He went when it was still very dark, and he departed and went out to a deserted place. Deserted place is eremos. And there he spent time in prayer. Now, you'd think, because this is the way I think, that Jesus, after a long day of ministry, man, I'm going to sleep in. You know what? I earned it. I'm going to rest. Maybe I'll get up and I'll go for a little light run. Then I'll have a brunch with the boys, the disciples. We'll get back together. I mean, nothing says post-Sunday recovery like a fruit plate and salmon over rice. But instead, Jesus wakes up early. He gets out the door to go to a quiet place because that's where the real food is. As you read more about the way of Jesus, you find that the quiet place, it wasn't just a one-time thing. The quiet place was a top priority for Jesus, an ongoing part of his life's rhythm. There's another story in Mark 6 where the disciples were just wasted after a few weeks of working in the way of Jesus, dead tired. So many people were coming and going that they didn't even have a chance to eat. And I know this kind of describes some of your life. At the end of the day, you're going, man, did I eat anything today? I mean, because you're working now out of your home, you're virtually schooling your kids, you still have to clean toilets and go grocery shopping and do whatever it is you got to do. You're living at a frenetic pace. And Jesus speaks into your life like he spoke into the life of his apprentices. Jesus said, come with me by yourself to a quiet place, to an eremos, and get some rest. Come with me. Mark Comer, the author of the book, The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry, he translates this passage. He says, this is what I think Jesus is saying to us today. He says, what you really need isn't a beer. It's not a night out at the movies. What you really need is time alone with me. Come away with me to a quiet place and get some rest. But to do that, you do need to get away from all of the noise, all the people. In the Gospel of Luke, Jesus went out to his quiet place no less than 9 times. One more story. This one's from Luke chapter 5, after he healed a man who had leprosy. And he specifically tells the guy, don't tell anybody else. I order you not to tell anybody else. But of course, the guy tells people. And the crowds come. We read, yet the news about him spread all the more, so that crowds of people came to hear him and to be healed of their sicknesses. I mean, crowds banging down the front door of Jesus was commonplace for him. But look at the next line. We read, but Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. This was his rhythm. This is what he did, to get away to the lonely place and pray. And in Greek, that phrase, lonely place, what do you think that is? It's eremos. There it is again. I love this. Jesus often withdrew. He frequently got away. He made a point to sneak off to pray on a regular basis, to be still with his Father. This was common for him. In Luke's gospel in particular, you can chart Jesus' life really along two main access points. One being how busy he got, how famous he got, how many people were coming after him, and the stillness that he found. The busier, the more stillness. But usually for you and I, it's the exact opposite. When life gets too busy, when life gets too hectic and people are desiring or are putting pressure on us for time, the quiet place is the first thing to go rather than the first thing that we go to. We forfeit unhurried time to just sit with God in quiet, to be still, to pray, to listen, to read a psalm. In seasons of busyness, we need more time in quiet places, not less. Listen, if you want to follow Jesus in the world, you first have to follow him into the wilderness, into the eremos. This practice of Jesus to spend time in the wilderness, the quiet place, has come to be known as a spiritual discipline of silence and solitude. Silence and solitude. And this sounds so simple. It sounds so basic. We should all be able to just nail this. This is foundational for our relationship with Jesus. But it's probably the most difficult of the spiritual practices. That's why we talk about it first. To be silent. To be in silence. To go away to a place without disruption. You see, it's difficult because there's two kinds of silence. When we talk about silence, there's external silence and internal silence. We'll take external first, right? This seems easy enough because really it's just the flip of a switch. We just turn everything else off. And we can do that, right? No cell phones, no screens, no headphones, no kids incessantly banging their spoon against the table. No noise. You just get away to a quiet place. Our spiritual patriarchs, they valued quiet. It's kind of a balm for the soul, for healing, an unlocked, open door into the presence of God. All of us, with a little thought, we can find a way to carve out, to create external silence. But we struggle with this. It's not an easy thing for us. And I want you to think about this. Why is it so difficult for us? If it seems so easy, why is it so difficult? I mean, why when we get in the car, do we have this prompting? I just gotta turn on NPR. I gotta have some noise going while I drive, or when we run, we have to have our earphones in, or when we wake up, we have to hear the why is it that our life is so filled with external noise? Could it be that we're using external noise to drown out the internal noise? Because it's the internal noise that's more difficult. If we want to experience internal silence, then we need to deal with a mental chatter that just never stops. It continues to go on. I mean, the running commentary in our heads on everything. I mean, literally everything. the replaying of a difficult conversation that we had with a friend, our lustful thoughts for the girl or the guy down the street, our fantasies, and I'm not just talking about sexual fantasies, our revenge fantasies. Imagining saying or doing that one thing to our most prevalent enemy. And then there's worry. We allow it to just stir inside of us, the obsessing over hypothetical scenarios, role-playing the future, thinking the absolute worst, or on the other side of that, idealizing, thinking the absolute best, dreaming of the perfect life, which in turn poisons our actual lives. It never gets quiet. See, the kind of silence I'm talking about is when you can silence both the external noise and the internal noise. Easier said than done. And then there's solitude. It's when you're alone with God and with your own soul. And now for clarification, solitude is not the same thing as isolation. Right? The two are worlds apart. Solitude is engaging. It's engaging the Heavenly Father. Isolation is escaping. Solitude is safety. Isolation is danger. Solitude is how you open yourself up to God. Isolation is painting a big target on your back for the tempter. Solitude is when you set aside time to nourish your soul, to welcome the Spirit of God into the mental chatter that He might do what you cannot do on your own, to quiet your mind, to fill your soul, to comfort you, to teach you, to sing over you. See, solitude, as somber as it sounds, is anything but loneliness. In his masterpiece, Celebration of the Disciplines, Richard Foster wrote, "Loneliness is inner emptiness. Solitude is inner fulfillment." In solitude, we're anything but alone. In fact, it's where many of us feel most connected to God. Henry Nouwen, he said it bluntly yet eloquently, he said, "Without solitude, it's virtually impossible to have a spiritual life." I want you to hear that. We do not take the spiritual life seriously if we do not set aside some time to be with God and to listen to Him. Solitude and silence. Now, if you're anything like me, then you've already compiled a list of reasons why silence and solitude are not for you. It's like, all right, what's the next spiritual discipline? This one's for somebody else. I mean, you're thinking, my life stage, you know what I've got going on right now, I'm a parent, I'm working, I don't have time for silence and solitude. I tried that before, and it doesn't work. Or, you know what, I'm just afraid, quite frankly, to be alone. The mental chatter just doesn't ever shut off for me. Or I've got ADHD. You've got a list. I want you to think about this. Jesus, the Savior King, he needed time for a quiet place. You think you can find your way without it? If you want to follow Jesus in this world, then you first have to follow him into the wilderness, into the eremos. The solution to your exhaustion, to the unfulfilled, weary life is not simply taking time off, but actually investing time in the presence of God. See, if you think about this, I think we have really two options here. I mean, we can continue to just do what we've been doing and kind of wave at Jesus as he's beckoning us to follow. We're just saying, hey, I see you, Jesus. Thanks, Jesus. I see you there. I see you. I mean, or kind of stick him into your overflowing suitcase of life and just kind of continue on in this crazy hurried pace of life, continuing to long for more, to long for more peace, to long for more joy, to long for more love, to long for more life. Or we can follow him. we can run after him. We can recapture this ancient yet timely practice and experience life that's truly life. Experience the way of Jesus. So what's it going to be for you? There is another way to live. We can live in the way of Jesus. But if you want to follow Jesus in the world, then you must first follow him into the wilderness. And so for the next week, for the next 7 days, I want to encourage you to try this on. Right? Just give it a try. Right? Trust Jesus. He really is faithful. He will meet you during this time. Carve out a little time every day. I'm not talking about 3 hours. I'm just talking about minutes. Start there. A place and a time. Just you and God. Maybe you have to get up before the kids, which probably means you have to go to bed a little bit earlier, which probably means you need to say no to something that you're accustomed to saying yes to. Maybe the early morning doesn't work for you, so you're going to have to carve out time during the middle of the day. Maybe it's your lunch, and you're just going to say, you know what, I'm going to go without lunch for the next 7 days, and I'm going to walk into the presence of God. I'm going to say no to something so I can say yes to Jesus. And it's simple, right? Just bring your Bible with you. You've got it. There's multiple apps that you can pull it up on. You can bring a physical Bible and just open and read. Where? Just open and read and let his word speak to you. Ask God to do something in your life. Confess your screw-ups. Let him know what you need. Just be still and say nothing. And allow him to speak to you. Just you and God. Your reality is safe with him. Be quiet before him and allow him to sing over you. His yoke is easy and his burden really is light. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful that you are here in this moment, God. You're with all of us, whether we're online or we're here in person today. God, in moments like this, it's easy for the tempter, for Satan to come in and just stir this pot in a way that goes sideways. And there's just this tremendous guilt, like I never measure up. I can't do that. I'm not able to do that. It won't work. You can never become, you'll never be that person who can have quiet time and solitude. And Lord, we just speak against that in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus. And Lord, we ask that you would silence those voices and we would just hear from you in this moment, God. That we would learn how to hear from you as you continue to speak life over us and peace over us and truth over us, redemption over us. God, you've come that we may have life and have it to the full, and you've made a way for that. Jesus, we praise you that you died on a cross for our sin, that we might be redeemed. And if you've never claimed that, claim it now. God, we claim that again and again and again, that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are our Savior. You are our Rescuer. It's by grace alone that we're saved. It's not by our works. It's by you. We need to be reminded of that. We need to hear from you regularly. We need to be built up by you. We need this other food source. And so, God, in these next 7 days, help us to find a place and a time to be still in your presence. Give us the courage and the strength. Say no to some things so we can say yes to you, God. That you might speak over us. That you might sing over us. That we might enter into your presence, God. Help us to go away to the Eremos, to that quiet place, and discover the prize. You are our prize, God. We love you, Lord. Forgive us when we just wave at you instead of chase after you. We want to be a people of the way, of your way. We need you, God. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to continue in our worship with our tithes and offerings. You know, before I was a Christian, I held everything close, everything tight, all my possessions. You know, I had what's called a scarcity mentality. You know, there's only so many pieces of pie, right? And when they're gone, there's nothing left. But Jesus flipped the script when I became saved and became a Christian. It's abundance mentality, right? It's He blesses us. Therefore, we return what He's given us in the form of an offering, in the form of a tithe. We do it with a joyful heart. That's what we're called to do as Christians. So if you're prepared to give today, there's a box out front. Some of us have given online, but it's a form of worship. So let me just pray for the offering, then we're going to do some music here. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for the abundance, the love that you give us. Jesus, the last 10 months have been really hard on all of us, and many have maybe turned away, or maybe we've gotten a little fearful of reaching out. And we just pray, Lord, that our offering, that the blessings that you give us, that they be used to reach the lost, to reach those that are hurting. Give us the strength to give with a joyful heart in abundance. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Why don't we stand and worship? We've got a song that, it's not a new song. It's a new song for me, but apparently we've done it before. It's pretty cool. It's No Longer Slaves. You know, we are sons and daughters of the living God, the God of the universe, and we're no longer slaves to fear. Here we go.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love is called me. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child. I am so
my songs of deliverance. We've been liberated from our bondage. We're the sons and the daughters. Let us see. Count on one thing, the same God never fails, will not fail me now, you won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God that's never late is working all things out, working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high. The lowest valley, yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my day. Oh, yes, I will. One thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now, as you won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God that's never late is working all things out, working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley, yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my day. Oh, yes, I will for all my day. Oh, yes.
to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of our land. And nothing can stand against when I choose to praise. I choose to pray, to glorify, glorify the name of our name. Nothing can stand against, and yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name.
Take my place, that you would bear my cross,
so good to come together and to sing and to allow those words just to cover us. King of glory gave his life for you and me. And that's what this is really all about. Who made a way for us to be right before our Heavenly Father so we can come into his presence. No fear, no condemnation. We just get to go to the throne of the King, our Heavenly Father. And that's what we talked about today. That's what silence and solitude is. Just coming into the throne room and understanding this, that that's the source. That's where life is. That's where we find it. That's the presence of God, and he alone is the prize. And so what's it going to look like this week in your life? I just want to encourage you. Try this on. Carve out some time this week to be still. Because if we want to follow Jesus in this world, then we need to first follow in him into the wilderness, into the eremos. Because here's how this goes, right? We're in here and it's fantastic. Or you're watching online and you experience God in this time. And then we turn it off, or we walk out the doors. And the hurry of life just swirls around us. Right, and it picks us up, and the words just keep coming. And then the mind kicks in, and it just doesn't stop. And friends, we need to fight against that. We need to push that back. We need to stand our ground and say, no, I'm going to be still in the presence of God. I'm going to tune out all the other noise. Spirit of God, help me to tune out the other noise and come to you in that quiet place and to hear your voice. Because it's when we hear his voice that we remember who we are because of who he is. And he says, you're his beloved. He says, you are his treasure. He says, you are his child. Live in that and get comfortable in that quiet place. All right, I'm going to pray for you. And then we'll go about our day, stepping where God, shoulder to shoulder, right? Wherever God takes us. Heavenly Father, God, I thank you that your way is really clear. It doesn't seem easy to us, God. It might not even seem possible. But God, you make all this possible. And so, Lord, we trust you. And God, I ask that you would give us the strength and the courage just to carve out some time, consistent time this week, to meet with you, that we may find life, that we might be connected to the vine. Instead of just waving at you, acknowledging you, that we would chase hard after you, God. And we would experience your presence, experience your grace, experience your joy, experience your love, be filled to overflowing, God. So that we might give you glory. And so that we might truly be salt and light to a world right now, God, that needs it. And Lord, I just want to lift up in this moment, I just want to lift up our country to you, God. In the chaos that is our country in these days, God, that you would bring your peace. Your peace, God, and that because you filled us, we can step into this storm and be calm and point people to you, God. You're our King. We praise you. We thank you in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Thanks, you guys. Have a fantastic week. Thanks for being here today.
Gonna be afraid, 'cause these waves are